join me in the invitation to gather? Have we forgotten that wilderness is not a place, but a pattern of the soul, where every tree, every bird, and beast is a soul maker?
Have we forgotten that wilderness is not a place, but a moving feast of stars, footprints, scales, and beginnings?
Since when did we become afraid of the night, and that only the bright stars count, or that our moon is not a moon unless it's full?
Have we forgotten that the wilderness is not a place, but a season, and that we are in its final hour?
Dear God, we are gathered here to contemplate with you for one moment in time. Today is only one moment in the long history of our church. Behind us stretch New England's many past congregations who each brought different worries and hopes to this sanctuary. After the present moment, future congregations will come and consider different problems. That makes now a fine time to sit still and contemplate change. Will there be different music in those future congregations? Will they be younger as a group, more rambunctious? Will they be more numerous? What cultures will they celebrate together? They will be our people gathering to contemplate with you, God. May we set the table for them and enjoy the excitement that change foretells. Today, New England is reaching out to welcome whoever is about to arrive. May we open our arms, not just in metaphor, but in a heartfelt hello. May we set aside any thoughts that we somehow know best and shake the hands of strangers, the ones who look like us, the ones who don't, the little wiggly ones, the ones that dress according to some other mother's taste, not mine. In this Lenten moment, we can't wait for Easter. And today, we can't wait to see what comes next. Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen.
To New England Congregational Church on this fourth Sunday in the season of Lent. A very special welcome to those who are guests with us. Please note your attendance in the Friendship Register before passing it to your neighbor. We hope you'll all join us for coffee and conversation in the narthex following the service. Please take a moment to read through the announcements in your bulletin. Of special note, our adult Lenten study, Finding God at the End of the World, continues on Wednesday with dinner at 5:30 p.m. and the study from 6 to 7. There's no cost and all are welcome. Next Sunday, we will be celebrating St. Patrick's Day with special liturgy and prayers and worship, and Irish dancing and theatrical storyteller Terry Lynch presenting Patrick and the Saints of the Emerald Isle following the service. We hope you'll all plan to join us. You can wear green or orange. Both are appropriate colors for St. Patrick's Day. Finally, we're looking for folks to assist us with planning our participation in this year's Aurora Pride Parade. This is a fun intergenerational event that's almost as much fun to plan as it is to participate in. If you're interested in helping out, please contact Director of Community Life, Kimberly Adams. And now remember that no matter who you are or where you are on your journey of faith and life, you are very welcome here. Please greet your neighbors as our children come forward. To see all of you this morning. How are you doing?
Good.
Good. That's great. I'm so glad. Did you notice that it was 1 hour less sleep this day?
No.
You didn't even notice, did you? Should we ask the adults if they noticed? How many of you noticed?
I lose 1 hour of sleep every night.
You lose 1 hour of sleep every night.
No,
okay.
2 hours. No.
Yeah. You're on the top bunk. That's always a good place to be.
I'm on the top bunk, but no one's on the bottom bunk because there's no bottom bunk.
That's fair. There's no bottom bunk. So we are now in the month of March. March is kind of special for one reason that I'm thinking of in particular. Is there something special that we celebrate for the whole month of March? The whole month? Yep. Okay, those are, you're almost there.
Women's History
Month.
That's what I was gonna say.
That's right, uh-huh.
And Lent,
definitely. But today I wanna talk a little bit about Women's History Month. I wanna share a story about a girl from long ago. I'm gonna show you her picture. We'll put it right here so you can see her. You do? Oh, wow. Well, let's go back in time together about 200 years to meet Antoinette Brown. When Antoinette was a young girl, her faith was important to her. She decided she was going to become a minister. But she was told, no, that is impossible. Because in those days, in this country, there were no women ministers. People laughed at Antoinette. They discouraged her. They told her she was being foolish and to give up this idea, but her mother supported her. Antoinette's mother pinned a white ribbon on her dress and said, "You can do it. I believe in you." When Antoinette Brown felt discouraged, she would touch the white ribbon and remember that she had support. There were many obstacles on the road. Antoinette's family could not afford to send her to college. Antoinette touched the white ribbon. She found a job as a teacher at the age of 16. She was a very smart person. Then she saved money for 4 years until she could afford to go to college herself. She attended Oberlin College, the first U.S. college to admit women. But when Antoinette asked to enter the program to become a minister, Oberlin College said, "No, that's impossible." I bet that Antoinette Brown touched her ribbon, but she didn't back down. Eventually, she entered the program, but once her studies were done, Oberlin College refused to give her a degree. Do you think she touched her ribbon then?
Yes.
Yeah, I think she probably did. Antoinette found other people who supported her, though. Friends invited her to speak in public and in churches. She gave speeches for women's rights and other social justice causes, and she inspired and supported many people, even without being a minister. 17 years after her mother first pinned that white ribbon on her dress, in 1853, Antoinette Brown was ordained as a minister. It's believed that she was the first woman ordained as a minister in our nation. What kind of minister do you think she was?
A minister?
Yeah, what kind of church do you think ordained her?
This one. No.
Well, you're close.
No, this was probably not built 1,000 years ago.
That's also true. She became a congregational minister. And what's the name of our church?
New England Congregational Church.
That's right, New England Congregational Church. That's right, Antoinette Brown is one of our faith ancestors. Reverend Antoinette Brown liked to give speeches to women in college. She remembered the obstacles that she faced when she was trying to become a minister, and she wanted to support young women with their goals, even when others might have said to them, "No, that's impossible." Antoinette Brown was the very first woman minister in our country. It takes courage to live our faith every day, day in and day out. It takes extra courage when people keep telling you no. Antoinette Brown had lots of courage. And I hope that her example will encourage each of us to live our faith even when others tell us it's impossible. Yes, do you have a comment? Yeah. 1848. Mm-hmm. She actually lived until 1921, so she got to see women get the vote in America. And she worked very hard for that. Yeah, thanks for asking. Well, let's share a prayer, and then you guys can head to Kid Zone. She was 96 when she died. This picture was from 1848, but that's not when she was born. I can't remember. 4 more years and she would be 100. So let's go ahead and have a prayer, then you guys can head to Kid Zone. Let's pray. Dear God, we're grateful for Antoinette Brown, our faith ancestor. Help us to have courage like she did and remember that nothing is impossible. Amen. Thank you all for being here today.
Thank you.
Let us be together now in a spirit of prayer. The psalmist tells us, and our choir just reminded us, that God is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. But everyone has their breaking point, right? At what point, God, do we push you over the edge? Is it with the slaughter and starvation of tens of thousands of innocents? Or with the unprovoked months-long siege of a sovereign nation? Or with 500,000 homeless and 17 million food insecure households in one of the richest nations in the world? Or is it the woefully apathetic response to a climate crisis of our own making? Or is it simply with the vitriol and hatred of half a nation toward the other half? We all know what it feels like to have our patience tested, to be pushed to the brink. How far is too far to push you, God? Or is what we do to ourselves punishment enough? The truth is, most of us really do try to make things better, to be better. Most of us long to see the best in our human family, to respond to the needs we see around us, to cultivate hope, to be the change we long to see. Where we are truly doing all that we can, may we have peace that it is enough. Where there is more that we can be doing, may we have the tenacity to see it through. And where the only thing we can do is pray, let us lift up our petitions now in the silence of our hearts. In big and little ways, may we each do all that we can to heal our hurting world. Amen.
Thank you.
Hear now a reading from the Gospel according to John, the 3rd chapter. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, Jesus said, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world, that God gave their only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people loved darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come into the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come into the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. Here ends the reading. John 3:16 is one of, if not the most, ubiquitous verses in the Bible. Everyone seems to know it. I'd love to say that the reason is because so very many people are so very familiar with Scripture. But I'm not sure that that's the case. I memorized it along with hundreds of other verses in our Southern Baptist Church's Wednesday night kids program. Maybe that's how other people learned this verse too. Maybe it's because Rollin Stewart cited the verse on his infamous t-shirts and banners. Do you remember the guy in the rainbow wig at sports events in the 80s? Maybe some do. Maybe that's how people know it. Maybe it's because Tim Tebow painted it under his eyes for the 2009 BCS Championships. Exactly 3 years later, he was playing for the Denver Broncos against the Pittsburgh Steelers. Denver had lost their previous 3 games by an average of 16 points. But during this game, they won with Tebow passing 316 yards and 31.6 yards per completion. Pittsburgh's time of possession was 31 minutes and 6 seconds. And the Nielsen rating for the game also peaked at 31.6. I don't know what any of those numbers mean. But I do know that John 3:16 was the top search item on Google the next morning. Maybe that's how it's so well known. Or maybe it's just because it's a really potent verse. After all, the leader of the Protestant Reformation, Martin Luther, did call it the gospel in a nutshell. It's such a well-known, well-loved verse that preaching a sermon on it reminds me of a story. One particular Sunday, the sermon had been going on endlessly, so it clearly wasn't one of mine. Finally, the minister's voice cracked, and he said, "What more can I say?" And one parishioner yelled out, "How about amen?" Preparing to write this sermon, I looked at the text and honestly asked, what more can I say? But the truth is, there is a lot more we can say about this verse than is usually said. And I intend to do just that. Let's start with what is usually said about this verse. God loves you. God sent God's only Son to die for you. If you believe in him, you will not perish. If you believe in him, you will have eternal life. Done and done. Growing up, I knew that this was a great verse for evangelizing the unsaved. The message was simple. God loves you and sent Jesus to die for you. The response was simple. Believe. And the results were really good news. Stay out of hell when you die. This verse had it all. And use it I did. Needless to say, telling my friends that they had to believe in Jesus to stay out of hell usually yielded one of two responses. Some of my friends did believe. I led them in praying what Baptists call the sinner's prayer. Basically, dear Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross in my place. Come into my heart and forgive me of my sins. Once converted, I could rest assured that my friends would avoid hell. As I said, there were two possible responses. Some of my friends weren't my friends anymore. God loves you. God sent God's only Son to die for you. If you believe in him, you will not perish. If you believe in him, you will have eternal life. That is usually what is said about this verse. Now let's move on to what is not usually said. Scholars tell us that belief in this context is not simply the intellectual assent to something. The word in Greek, usually translated as belief, is really about obeying, complying, and trusting. The kind of believing talked about in this verse isn't the same as believing that your child is telling the truth about the missing cookies, or believing that the earth is billions of years old, or believing that blondes really do have more fun. Furthermore, this kind of belief is not creedal, is not dogmatic. It's not about having the right belief about Jesus or the incarnation or the Trinity or the cross or anything else. This kind of believing means buying into Jesus' message, obeying his teaching, complying with his mandate to love, and trusting that this really is a way to a better world, to eternal life. And that brings me to the second thing that I'd like to talk about from this verse, eternal life. The verse is typically translated to state that believers will have eternal life, future tense. Interestingly, though, in Greek, the verb for to have is present tense. The verse doesn't suggest that believers will have eternal life. It states that believers have eternal life in the present, right here, right now. Friends, this is a radical verse, and I'm coming to believe that Martin Luther was right. It really is the gospel in a nutshell, because it tells us how to get saved. It tells us how to get saved. I'll say that once more because I forgot a word. Because it doesn't tell us how to get saved by simply believing in Jesus, and certainly does not tell us how to stay out of hell. This verse is radical because it says that those who believe in Jesus, those who obey, comply with, and trust in his teachings enough to actually do them, they experience eternal life right here because they are bringing that abundant life, that realm of heaven, to the very earth they walk on and the people they share it with. Let me be clear, though. I'm not saying that those believers won't also experience it in the hereafter. Only that that's not the focus of this verse or of Jesus' gospel. It's about here and now. Tim Tebow says that he chose John 3:16 because, quote, it's what gives us Christians hope. I have to say that I want to agree with him, but not because believing in Jesus saves me or anyone else from eternal damnation. It gives me hope because believing in Jesus means living like Jesus and bringing the hoped-for future into the right now present. It gives me hope because it reminds me of what's possible here and now for the world. But that kind of world change doesn't just happen. It takes people living the truth of Jesus' message and not just believing in Jesus as some sort of post-mortem fire insurance plan. So there you have it. What's not usually said about John 3:16? and why I still think it's the gospel in a nutshell. Do you believe? May it be so. Amen.
Is both our reason for being and the goal of all our doing. We dedicate ourselves, our gifts, and this church to love's work in the world. Amen.
Thank you.
And now, dear friends, let us go forth to believe in Jesus, to live like Jesus, and to bring the hoped-for future into the right now present. And may the love of God, the friendship of Jesus, and the peace of God's Spirit bless and keep you now and until we meet again. Amen.